commercial break. Had no idea who it was until we read that. That does not even look like Sean McVay.
15-year-old Sean McVay making it happen.
Looks like Danny Partridge. Does anyone know
who that is? Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Sure. Yeah.
Thank gosh, someone knew who that was.
I think I love you.
Hey. Wait,
wow.
Is it Danny or is it the little one?
We'll go with Danny. No problem.
Time for stories to start your movie. Let's move on quickly before anyone else can make any comments. Mariano Rivera.
But you're well worth the comment because I know it too.
Yeah. Became the first player to be unanimously voted into baseball's Hall of Fame. The closer won 5 World Series and was an All-Star 13 times. CeCe, what'd you make of this?
Oh, he's amazing. I'm a Yankees fan also, so, man, I got a lot of enjoyment, a lot of relief when they went to the bullpen to bring him in to be able to shut things down.
Automatic.
I was able to see him a number of times live, and if you think that he was a great player, as a human being, just as good. Congratulations.
Yeah. Changed baseball, man, with that cutter. Like, everybody throws a cutter now because of him. He threw 2 pitches, fastball, cutter. Go ahead, good luck. Oh, unbelievable.
And good night. Yeah. Moving on, 2019 marked another year both Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens did not make the Hall of Fame. Both got just over 59% of the vote when 75% is required. Nick, what do you think? Will these two ever get into the Hall?
I don't think so, and it's criminal. I mean, you got 14 MVPs and Cy Youngs between them. You got Bonds, who has more walks than Mickey Mantle has games. Mm. You got Roger Clemens, who is the all-time leader in Cy Youngs and won an MVP at the pitching position. We know there are steroid users in the Hall. We know it. To keep out arguably the greatest player ever and arguably the greatest pitcher the last 50 years is an absurdity, but they keep doing it.
And I'm with you 100%. They both deserve to be in the Hall of Fame. Here's the other thing. Like, the voters finally unanimously selected Mario Rivera. Maybe now they'll take away some of these biases and say, hey, you can't tell the story of baseball without these two in the Hall.
I'm totally against both of you. I ain't with the PEDs. I'm with getting up early. I'm with staying late. All right? He got assistance. That's the reason why his numbers are greater than Mickey Mantle and all that. Yeah, he's taking a shot in his butt. Get out of here with that.
In the NFL, the Chiefs fired defensive coordinator Bob Sutton following their loss to the Patriots. KC gave up over 40 points per game in their losses this year. Stink, do the Chiefs have to make this move?
I think that I think you have to have better personnel. I don't think there's any question about that. But the fact that you didn't seem to adjust during those games where you were giving up those points, you come down to overtime and you've got them in 3rd down and 10 3 different times on a 75-yard drive, and you can't get off the football field.
What about blitzing?
Yeah,
make them throw high.
You're
tackle,
sitting there,
you're off the field.
Right, you're sitting there playing too high. Right, you're playing man cover 2 the whole time, going, okay, we're gonna stop them with this. Change it up. I mean, if I'm going to go down, I'm going to go down with a fight, right? Somebody's getting a bloody nose at the end of the game, even if we lose it.
I try not to call for people's jobs. I said yesterday on this show that I thought Bob Sutton would be fired today. He was fired one day early. The Chiefs need a fresh mind at defensive coordinator.
All right, let's stick with football now. To the Eagles, a bombshell report came out this week calling the future of the franchise Carson Wentz both egotistical and selfish, cited anonymous players. A number of Wentz's teammates have since come out defending their quarterback. Yesterday, it was Jason Kelce who spoke out, ripped the report, saying, "I go to war any day of the week and twice on Sunday with guys like Carson Wentz." Mark, what was your reaction to this?
My reaction is somebody, there's somebody within the organization that's disgruntled. It's kind of like you talked about with Cole Beasley, it's always somebody else's fault. Carson Wentz, having met with the Eagles, having met with Carson Wentz, and just watched those guys rally around him a year ago. I did an Eagles game with Carson Wentz. They absolutely love that guy. For the majority of that team, they love that guy. And that guy's an unselfish football player that puts the team first. So I don't know what you would, I heard CC talking about this yesterday. And, if it's a disgruntled wide receiver that's not getting his shine that he thinks he should get, or because Nick Foles comes in and distributes the ball a little bit differently than Carson Wentz does, you're mad about that. But the bottom line is, I think the guys who have stood up, the guys who have come to the forefront, the guys who aren't cowards that leave things anonymous, you know, the guys who have come to rally around Carson Wentz, those are the guys that I would put more merit in, and those are the guys that I would trust more.
Right. There's a number of things coming out of this report that I don't like, because the reporter had plenty of time to be able to ask questions. He could have went to all the press conferences. He could have questioned Carson Wentz. There's a number of things he could have done to validate this report that he decided not to do. So I know my I don't have a school named after me as far as broadcasting and journalism, but just some of the basics as far as following up, getting someone to be able to go on the record, those things would have helped his credibility. Now, I am a person that will have ex-teammates say some of the same things they said about Carson Wentz. Oh, he's selfish. Yeah, you damn right. You better be selfish. To be a good football player, you have to be selfish. Now, you can be selfish within the team concept, but you got to get yourself ready. No one else is getting you ready. So I do believe there's a great deal of selfishness that you have to take into being a great teammate. Was it about ego? No, it wasn't about ego. But anytime you're good at something and you have confidence, you know what people say? Oh, he's got an ego. Well, tell me who you know does not have an ego. So I'm not necessarily believing in the reports, the anonymous players and everything. I believe there was one wide receiver that might have had a problem with it or two. That's the way they go. I believe the Eagles' biggest problem is their offensive coordinator. I believe that Mike Groh, we don't know if he is cut out for this. So even guys complaining is basically the backlash of losing your quarterback coach, Frank Wright, and John DeFilippo. You lost both of them, and then you bring in someone who's never called plays in the NFL. There have always typically been problems, and I think that's more of the problem in Philadelphia now than Carson Wentz.
And one of the other things in this report was that once DeFilippo and Reich went out the building, Carson was able to kind of run over Mike Groh, which speaks to C's point. I think this actually can be a positive moment for the Eagles, because there's so much noise surrounding Foles and Wentz. Foles is going to almost assuredly be on a different team next year. Now they have a rallying point around their quarterback. You have the leaders of the team, Fletcher Cox, Lane Johnson, Jason Kelce, some of the most prominent, most established, most respected guys on the team, going on the record saying, this is our guy. And the other reason I think it can be a positive is, even in criticism that you think is unfair, even in anonymous criticism, I think you can have a moment of introspection and saying, how much of that is true? The person that said I carry myself like I've won multiple Super Bowls and I've won a playoff game, even if it's mostly unfair.
Yeah, but how should I carry myself? Right. Wait a second. This reporter, what does he know about how you should carry yourself?
Well, that's not, it wasn't like, his words. I mean, it wasn't the reporter's words.
Shouldn't you carry yourself like a champion? Shouldn't you have your chin up?
Do you have to win?
Right.
Did you change when you got Super Bowl?
No.
I think you're misinterpreting what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, even if the majority of this is unfair, or even if the majority of this is untrue, if I'm Carson Wentz and I'm saying somebody somewhere, whether it's one guy or a half dozen guys, said this about me, what about it do I just totally disregard? And what about it do I say, okay, so in that article when they said there was a veteran player that come tried to talk to me, like Brian Westbrook talked about yesterday, and I ignored him. Is that something I do? Do I need to have a more of an open ear? Even if most of it is, of course I have a big ego. That's how I got here from North Dakota State. Of course I'm selfish. That's what 98% of pro athletes are. So I don't think this has to be a negative, especially because so many guys have come on the record saying Carson is our guy. But I also think it's something Carson can grow from, even if only part of it, even if only 10% of it really resonates within it.
My question, and maybe you guys can answer this, is if we pretty much assume that it was the wide receivers that spoke out or whoever.
No, that's just me. Don't put that on you guys. I agree.
I think he said that too, and I assumed it was either Alshon Jeffrey or someone else that it wasn't getting the ball. I mean, it wasn't Zach Ertz. We know that for sure. How does that not split a locker room? I mean, if we know that, my point is that Carson Wentz knows
people
that.
Are too much into this locker room thinking there's some type of, oh, man, there's like this really fine balance and everything. You got a bunch of crazy guys.
Okay, well, maybe.
I don't think it was Alshon Jeffries, and I'm not going to say who I think it is because it's not fair to them.
Of course.
You have a lot of dysfunction within an NFL locker room that is normal. All right? They got a job to do. As a wide receiver, I got a job to do. Carson Wentz is the quarterback of the future. To me, the number one thing is, not that Carson Wentz looks at the article and reads about it. The number one thing is, Carson Wentz needs to get better as a quarterback. All right? He is in a critical year. this year that passed where he couldn't finish it up, this was a critical year for him. To me, that's what we should be talking about. How much better does he get releasing the ball? How much better does he get in reading pass coverage? How much better does he get as far as protecting his body? Those are the things I think will be long-lasting and will be the subject matter as we move on compared to these other talking points of, I had a veteran guy come up to me and I didn't listen to him. I don't think those things are really relevant.
Well, I just wanted to clarify. I wasn't saying it was Alshon Jeffery. I'm just saying
we shouldn't say that.
No, of course not. And it was a name that just did come up. Well, we assume that.
I think there's a couple of things here within a locker room. There's always, like Chris said, there's five guys that are touched that you know they're touched, and you got to nurture them. You know, I mean, it's just the way every locker room is. And then on top of that, there's always guys in there that you're not going to pick out curtains with. There's certain guys in the locker room that I'm not hanging out with you. You know, I respect you as a football player. I respect you as a man. As long as you do your job and you go out there and you ball, we're good.
Like, right. And I'm hoping we don't have a conflict.
Right. We're not going to hang out. Like, that's not part of what we're going to do. So that's part of the deal. I think with Carson Wentz, anytime you come off an injury as significant as his injury is, there's a growth process of learning how to play that way. And that's the hardest thing. Most guys have great success their second year after an ACL reconstruction.
Yep.
Most guys aren't Adrian Peterson. They're not freak shows. Most guys, I think the psychological barrier to overcoming an injury and reestablishing what your new 100% is. Because a lot of guys come out of injury and they think, well, if I could just get to 100%. And my advice to them is you'll never get to 100%. Mm-hmm. But you know what? If 80% of what 100% used to be for you, if you can get to 80% and that's good enough to play, that's your new 100%. That establish it there and say, I'm good to go. You have to be able to get over that hurdle mentally and say, this is where I'm at. It's plenty good enough to play. I have to alter my game a little bit, and that's okay. And so until you're willing to do that, you're always going to be dragging that I'm not quite 100% along with me, and you'll never play to your potential.
Instinct makes a great point. That's also the growth of the player where you realize I'm not as athletic as I used to be. So now the fundamentals, as you come back from injuries and as you get older, they become more important. So now you can actually become a better player because you understand and can function mm-hmm. at a higher level because of the setback of the injury.
So anyway, here we are now that this article came out. We're all talking about it. Nick, you mentioned that the Eagles could use this as a rallying point. I guess I'm just curious how this can bring the team
okay,
together.
Okay, so because if I'm Carson Wentz, no matter what guys are saying, or no matter what my friends and family are saying, that, hey, they're going to be excited that you're back. They're glad they know you're their guy. There's a voice in the back of your head that's like, man, are the guys in the locker room, do they believe in Foles more than me? And now you have essentially the entirety of what would be the Eagles leadership council, Fletcher Cox, Jason Kelce, Lane Johnson, Jason Peters, the only guy whose name come to mind that didn't send out a tweet about this, that is on the record saying, we love this guy. This is the guy we want. And so to me, if I'm Carson Wentz and I heard people on the some anonymous person on the staff thinks Nick's a jerk, and then Chris comes out and you come out publicly say, absolutely not, we love him. I say, okay. You know what I mean? Whatever self-consciousness I had, whatever it was, whoever wouldn't put their name on it, what do I give a damn about them?
Come on, Dustin.
Exactly.
And,
but the people that matter,
right,
they've got my back. That's the point that I'm making. For a guy who probably was emotionally down that for the second straight year couldn't finish, for the second straight year the team seemed to click a little bit with Nick Foles. Now he's got validation. It came in an odd form, but validation.